What is up, guys? Fahan here with Zah once again, and today we are at Dirt Wheel, the official dealer of KTM in Singapore.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and this is their showroom at Bukit Merah right here, and here we have a representative from KTM, Abang Syarul. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you.
Thank you so much for, you know, opening up to us. I mean, this is a really awesome opportunity after can we say Ducati showroom?
Yeah.
That I think we got a request from Kai, whom we reviewed the bike earlier, to do a review of the road review lah, more like a tour lah.
Yeah, a tour. Yeah.
A tour lah. Okay, so I've did my research about KTM. Mm-hmm. KTM is a very popular brand overseas lah, but they are very well known for dirt bikes.
Yeah.
Especially in the Americas, in Europe, there's a very popular dirt bike along with Husqvarna, in which KTM also owns. But in Singapore, it's very weird. Because in Singapore, KTM is not known for the bikes. They're known for the Duke and the RCs.
Yep. So if I may, if you want to know the history of the bikes lah, in Singapore, yes, KTM came to Singapore back in the 90s with the scramblers that we know of, which is what we have over here. Back then, we have the EGS 125, the EXC 125, and then LC4 400cc. So those are the older generations of KTMs. And then somewhere in the late 90s, KTM revamped their design. KTM changed the whole concept of motorcycles. So they embarked into street bikes. So then we have the Dukes, then we have the RCs, of course the very popular RC8. Now the later generations will be the Super Dukes, Super Duke GT, Super Adventures and so on. Yes, if you're talking about popularity of the dirt bikes, street legal dirt bikes in Singapore, we've been missing that for quite some
maybe
time.
Maybe because Singapore got no off-road lah.
Yeah, Singapore got no place to play. Yeah. And the trend of riders investing on off-road, strictly off-road purpose kind of bikes, it's there already. So instead of getting a street legal one, you use it for off-road, might as well get the off-road bikes straight away. Yeah. So the opportunity and to get that bikes is available right now lah. Plus the LTA tagging and so on and so forth lah. So meaning you will have a off-road purpose bike which is legal to be used here in Singapore and also in Malaysia lah. Yeah.
Okay, so Abang Syarul, maybe you want to start with what KTM Singapore has to offer to our riders out there.
To offer well, I would like to what I can offer is of course the best service and one of the best bikes available in the market.
Ready to race, huh?
Ready to race, yes. So KTM have been with that motto for so long, and we have it in our blood lah. So why it's called ready to race? Because you need minimal transition from street to off-road, regardless whether it's going to be for motocross or for the tracks. So meaning what you have is a bike that's ready to be used for the road and ready to be raced. The tracks lah. Okay. So without much modification and changes lah. And then after that you can revert back to street use again.
Okay, that's really awesome.
Yeah, pretty awesome, man. Of course, we produce good quality bikes. We use quality parts. We have our in-house suspension which is from WP. So the quality and the performance part, of course, I believe everybody knows that KTM is good lah. So that's what we can offer you guys lah.
So let's see the range of KTM models that
so if we were to go here, these are the only two street legal off-road models that we have over here. EXC 150 TPI. I mean, a lot of riders knows that there are no more two strokes available in the market. This is a two stroke.
Oh, this is a two stroke?
Yes, this is a two stroke TPI. TPI is equivalent to EFI, but it's for two strokes lah. So this is a fuel injection two stroke engine. 150cc. So it has, yes. So it has
pergi maha pergi.
Of course, power to weight ratio is very very good. Plus, of course, we all know the capabilities of two-stroke engines lah. How much horsepower it can give. Why they bring the CC down to 150? It's because we are familiar with the EXC 200s or EGS 200s before. So what we have here is a bike which is a bit more power, but 150cc. So they make the bike lighter, engine smaller, but able to produce a bit more power. So now the current generation is all about making it smaller in terms of CC, making it lighter but a bit more power. So this is 150, and then if we were to go over there, so this one is also an EXC based engine, two stroke, but this is the 300 TPI. So this is the EXC 300 TPI 6 days, as you can see, 6 days over here. So
why,
yeah.
Why 6 days?
6 days, yes, because if why? You add one more day, you become 1 week really. Okay, 6 days is actually a short abbreviation for International 6 Days in Europe.
Oh,
so
okay.
Every year in Europe mainly, they have this International 6 Days in Europe. So it starts all from somewhere in the late 90s or 2000s, early 2000s. Mm-hmm. So what KTM do is that they pay homage to the country that organized the
which
6 Days.
Portugal lah.
Oh. So this one Portugal organized in 2019. So 2020 we have the 6 Days Portugal. So if you see France, that means France was hosting the 6 Days the year before lah. This is a special edition also, only produced in that particular year. So meaning all the liveries, all the decals, right? Will mm-hmm. only be produced for that particular year. If you were to do it, or you ask KTM, I can have a 6 Days France, they don't have it available lah. It's only for that particular year.
Okay.
Oh, this one is a price a bit more because of the parts that is available on the bike lah. Mm-hmm. The triple clamps, mm-hmm. even the rims. There's a laser printed with 6 Days.
Okay.
And then if the sprockets, you can see that super sprockets, the colors ah. Everything. So as you can see, this is also laser printed to the
It's not sticker.
Sticker only certain portions.
Oh, certain portion. Yeah. Okay. So to make part, it, the main part is mostly
laser printed,
correct? Inside, yeah.
Yes. Mm. And plus with the seat also, color scheme of the seat is also produced for that particular year as well.
I see. Mm. Okay, that's cool, man. That's
cool. Yeah. This bike also, you don't need a key to start.
Oh. Transponder.
Tak. Should I say no lah? Okay. For all our off-road bikes, right, you don't need a physical key to turn on the ignition.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But then, yeah, of course, you're able to lock the handle lah. That's the safety feature.
Oh, wow, that's so
cool.
So
you want to sabo somebody, just start the bike
then run, and then bike overheat lah. Please don't do that lah. Similar like you know, if you are familiar with XR4R last time,
yes,
that one also got no key, no
so
ignition.
These are mainly the two dirt bikes that you guys are.
Two dirt bikes that we are selling for street use.
Mm.
So for off-road, there will be a different range really. Off-road, they will be recognized as SX. Or for the Husqvarnas, it will be the FS, and so on and so forth, different model names. So off-road, you got no lights, no radiator fans, yeah. So there's difference.
So the wheels, you guys also got the Motard version?
Motard version, yes, we have. Motard conversion. If we were to proceed over here, yes.
The road the popular bikes, ones are the on naked the range, which is known as the Dukes.
The Dukes.
Okay. Not Dukes of Hazzard.
So at a glance, if you can see that these two don't really look that different. Okay, so what we have here is the 2021 390 Duke.
It looks like a Class 2B.
Yeah, because the 200 and 390, they follow the same chassis design, ergonomics.
Okay.
So one way to differentiate is, of course, you take a look at the label itself. You can see a 390 or 200 itself. Second will be if you can see the meter. So the 200 Duke using the LCD. Meter whereby the 390 Duke using the full color TFT. All our displays, I mean the latest generation of LCDs and the TFT screens, when you switch on lah, there will be a welcome, ready to race. So for the headlamps of the 390 Duke, you can see. I think this is a common feature that's available right now, which is the daytime running lights, the DRL, and followed by the high beams, low beams, and the pole light lah. So that's the 390 Duke. Another feature I would like to share about our 390 Dukes and RCs, which I don't think is available on any other Class 2A bikes, is the ride-by-wire.
Oh, okay.
Right. Of course, it's ride-by-wire popular with the bigger CC bikes, Class 2. But I believe this is the only Class 2A bike that uses ride-by-wire. So for those who are not familiar, what is ride-by-wire? Which is this throttle don't have a physical cable to the throttle body. Which is all by sensor input.
So I'm like shocked, you know, because usually ride by wire is those very premium 1000 cc bikes that has it.
So for that, you know, that kind of technology that's been put in to the bikes, so you rest assured the quality and the performance is there also. The downside, of course, the price.
The price, is there any lagging? Because since it's throttle by wire,
Okay.
Just curious,
I would have to say that so far we don't have any issues with the ride by wire. It is fair to be skeptical about it, lah. Will there be any lagging? Because there's no direct input. But so far, this unit and all to the other Class 2 units, we have no issues. Plus, you can also do a diagnostic test to see how much throttle input you have. So meaning if you feel like it's lagging, our technician can just simply go to the diagnostic tool, take a look at it, okay, see what kind of input it's supposed to give. So let's say if you open up to the full, right, it's supposed to read 100%, but then it's reading something else, that means there's something wrong with the TPMS, the throttle position system lah. Sensor, yes. Yeah.
Okay.
So that's the right by wire. And plus levers also adjustable. Adjustable levers can be found in a lot of bikes right now, regardless what the brand.
Definitely. Yeah.
So, but I believe this is the feature that's not available in any other bikes. Plus, how many bikes you know that you can handle lock both sides?
Ah, right? Okay.
So cool, man. The 390 Duke, you are able to lock it on either left.
Okay.
Or you can also lock it
on the right.
On the right side. Oh, ni tak ada lah.
Sorry, is the 890, is it?
Yes.
Okay. The old one have.
The old one have, right? Yes.
Alamak, brothers.
The old 390.
Look at this, guys. This is Harif. We reviewed his Duke 390. Yeah. Thanks for coming.
Okay.
Just around the corner.
Okay. Padahal dia tadi dengan kita sah.
My mistake. Okay. That one.
This one.
Left and right.
Oh. This one 390 lah, the old one lah.
Yes.
Okay.
So what you see here, this one is a 2019
model.
2019-2020 model. This is the 2021 model.
Okay. So we move on to
this one. Yeah, the 890 Duke R.
Okay. Single seater, is it?
No. We give the pillion seat as well lah, but it's also we also give the single seater to the customers as well. So at least you know, if you ride alone most of the time, single seater tak payah, you know, you don't need to go and buy. So you're there.
Okay, and I have to say the size, oh my god, even though it's 890cc, it looks like a class 2A.
It's not bulky as a class 2. The commonly that we see on the road.
This is the trend. Moving forward, I think all the class 2 bikes are getting smaller and the class 2B bikes are getting bigger.
Yes. A lot of advanced sophisticated class 2 motorcycles right now, they make power management a bit more gentle on riders as well. But don't get it wrong, even though the power delivery is gentle, but the power is still there. So that's how advanced technology is. So this is the 890 Duke R. There is a base model 890 Duke, but we don't bring it to Singapore. Later as we go on, you hear the R. This R, that R, that model R. So one thing you can expect from an R model is an orange frame. If it's not R, it won't be orange.
And that is the KTM signature, orange frame.
So this is the A90, is the later generation of the mid CC size Dukes. Previously we have the 790 Duke. And the A90 improvement on the bike will be the brakes. Now it's fully Brembo brakes, 4-port calipers. And then we have this. Okay, this one is interesting. Alright, if you are familiar with Brembo RCS, Brembo RCS 19, RCS 16, what we have here is the Brembo MCS. So it has a similar capabilities of RCS, and plus you can also
toggle the
setting. Meaning if you are gonna ride normally street use, you can set it at 19 so that valve, the power delivery is just nice to use on the streets. So what happens if you're gonna do hard riding or track riding with the setting at 19? As you go lap by lap, your brake starts to heat up.
Yes.
You start to feel that the brake pressure starts to fade.
Right? Brake fade lah.
Yeah. Not go to a full brake fade yet, but it starts to fade a bit. Yeah lah, something like that. Okay. So then what you can do, you can adjust to 20 or 21. So it increase the pull pressure.
Okay. Right. And you can adjust this while riding.
While riding, yes, but you need to have some level of skill to do it lah. Right. And you are familiar with a lever remote adjuster. Okay, so over here is the lever adjuster. So you can adjust it over here. Nampak? Di sini. This one.
So, okay.
Alright, and then you can see that small thing over there is supposed to have a remote adjuster that you can bring all the way to the left. So when you want to adjust your lever position, rather than you come here to adjust with your left hand, you can just do it over here. This is a feature that commonly you can see on track bikes, sports bikes lah. Where you can see another physical cable running across.
Okay. So you have while throttling, you can still adjust.
Yes.
That's so cool, man.
And plus, I don't know if you are aware that those racers lah, pro riders, whether pro or amateurs lah, they do a lot of work when it's on the street. On the street, it's not about just focusing. They still do things. Same goes with F1 lah. There are some minor adjustments you need to do, and they do it on the main straights where it's the longest. So that's where they do that adjustments, change the setting.
Sometimes you see MotoGP, they were like that.
Definitely ada adjustment they do. And plus all that, that blue, red, blue, green button, all lah. That one for the mapping, so on and so forth lah. So this is the A90 based on a parallel twin A90cc. It gives out about 125 horsepower. Right. Okay, you heard about the latest RC8C. There's only 100 pieces produced based on the same engine, but they want up spec lah. They want 140 horsepower, 140 kilos. So one to one. Okay. 100 pieces only in the world lah.
My God, how many coming in Singapore?
Don't have.
Oh, that's so sad.
Nobody order. Okay, so the sad thing about the RC8C, when it's released available for sale, the bike was sold out in 4.5 minutes. Sekejap lah. But that's only for track lah, track purpose bike.
You understand?
The other limited edition bikes that we have forced road use will be the Super Duke Double R. Or you can hear people talk about the Double R. That's a Super Duke Double R based on the Super Duke R, but it have carbon parts on it lah. So that one they call it the 1-to-1 power to weight ratio, 180 kilos, 180 horse. Very light, very powerful.
I feel like buying a KTM. Already.
500 pieces all over the world. 3 pieces only.
Oh my gosh.
3 aja.
In Singapore.
In Singapore. Coming lah. Not here
coming
yet.
So next we move.
Already have anyone?
Yes, three taken already.
Three taken already.
Yes. Wow. One of them is me. So if we have a mid CC size street bike naked bikes, we also have the mid CC bike adventure. Adventure trend starts to pick up sometime, I would say 15 years ago. That time GS was dominating it lah. GS 11, GS 1150, then GS 12, then the liquid cool 1250. So GS, of course, even though I'm KTM, I'm talking about BMW now, but yeah, we have a lot of admiration for them.
Because they are the pioneers lah
in the market of adventure bikes.
Yes,
BMW has already set the benchmark.
Yes.
So the next nearest rival to BMW is KTM lah. In my personal opinion.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank
you very much.
So, I see that KTM is the next closest.
You never angkat, right?
Later, see me for your free gift. So of course, I mean, we here at KTM, when we talk about bikes in general lah, of course we have a lot of respect for other brands as well.
Definitely.
Regardless whether it's Japanese or Continental lah. But because we are a Continental brand, we are also compared closely with the other Continental brands. And when you look at Adventure, we are compared closely to BMW as well. So if BMW have their F850 900, if I'm not mistaken, the new one, we have the 790 and the 890 Adventure will be coming also. So this, what we have here is the 790 Adventure, and the frame is orange, so it's the Adventure R. Okay, so we have the base model also, the 790 Adventure, the frame is black in color lah. One of the unique features that's not available in any adventure bikes or any bikes in that matter in the market lah, is the tank.
Okay, this is the tank.
The tank.
Oh my god.
Yes, it's a low slung tank, so you have 20, the tank is capacity is 20 liters. So KTM managed to design a tank whereby you bring all that central mass down at the bottom.
So low center of gravity,
so that means it handles better front.
I see.
This will be the R, Adventure R, or the base model, 790 Adventure, will be a highly recommended adventure bike for entry level class 2 riders lah, if you ask me. Very easy to ride, fun also. And it has LED lights, adjustable suspension WP, adjustable rear suspension, ride by wire, color TFT, plus 12 volt charger.
This one you want to go touring ah, you just put in.
Yes, there's no need for you to add on anything. It's there.
Everything is there.
So this is the 790 Adventure.
I don't mind going to Pakistan on this.
Which part you want, bro?
100 is beautiful to me, and then this one also very beautiful to me.
It's beautiful, beautiful, very nice. You will enjoy one. Your smile until here, I tell you. Okay. Other unique features is the air intakes. Normally when motorcycles, air intakes is facing.
Air intakes
facing forward kan?
Forward. Yeah.
Yes, the 790 Adventure air intakes facing rearwards. Yes.
See?
Yeah. So it's in, under the seat.
It's under the seat.
Facing to the back.
Oh, okay.
With that design, we able to minimize the amount of dust
that enters the intake.
Enters into the intake while you're traveling forward. So and then if you take out these side panels, which are they are just button clip. So you take out, then you will have that naked punya look.
Oh, yeah. I have to say the design language of the 790 Adventure R, it really looks like a dirt bike.
Oh yes.
It's very different from most adventure bikes that we usually see. In the front is like a macam dirt bike.
Macam dirt bike lah. And plus when they design parallel twin engine and then low slung tank, that geometry and ergonomics on the bike, much more fun to ride, much more capable bike to ride. If you compare this to the Super Adventures lah, this will be a lighter, a much more manageable bikes if you were to go off-road.
Looking at the design, good. Looks like a good off-road bike.
Yeah.
I have to say.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Okay. Then, so these are the Adventure. Okay, we have this nice looking bike right at the back of our showroom. So this is the Super Duke GT. So we have the Super Duke R. We also have the Super Duke GT, which is also the touring version of the Super Duke lah. Based on the same engine, 1290, actual CC is 1301, 75 degrees V-twin engine, twin spark. So it has the same cap engine as the Super Duke. It's just that the horsepower is toned down a bit. So this is more catered for long distance travel, bigger tank, 23 liters, adjustable screens, cruise control, ride by wire, heated grips. Oh yeah, heated grips.
Definitely you need definitely it for touring. Yeah.
Heated grips, then got heated seat as well lah.
So okay, heated seat also. Yeah. Wow.
So I have, you know, customers asking, "Eh, I don't need heated seat here in Singapore, in Malaysia." I say, "Yeah, but when you are in the condition, for example, you travel in Malaysia on the highways and then it rains and then the rain stop, that is when you really appreciate that you have heated grips."
You notice that they also has holes for side panels,
Correct. So there's no additional brackets for the side boxes or the side panniers. So when you take out the boxes, it give you that clean.
Oh yeah, yeah, you just give that clean look.
Clean look. So it can be look as, oh, they macam naked bike but with a bit of fairing. Oh yeah, and then don't get me wrong, you put this in the hands of a very capable rider. Yeah. We saw a couple of these in Sepang before, in the track days. Yes. Can fight with the sports bikes lah. Like I said, depends on the.
Surprising for naked bike.
Oh yes. Oh, even the Adventure pun boleh.
Oh okay.
Ready to race.
Oh, it's ready to race.
They are
you anytime.
They are Super Adventures also play Sepang. Ada. God. Okay.
Yeah, so let's move on to that one. Holy Grail for this showroom. Yes.
We are down to the last bike in the showroom. Okay, what we see here is the 1290 Super Adventure R 2021. The long awaited Super Adventures.
Oh my god.
So, if I may, this will be the third generation of Super Adventures that we have. Super Adventure started in 2015. And then the second generation was the 2017, and this is the third. So the long-awaited one, based on a lot of the nice cool stuff that's onto the bike lah, the chassis, the suspension, the wheels, the design of the tank itself. So the tank is adopting what the 790 has, which is again a low slung tank, so goes all the way to the bottom. So if you are familiar of you ridden adventure bikes before. Alright, when you hop on and you bring it upright, you feel a bit like
heavy.
Right? So okay, to be fair lah, I mean this bike have not much fuel in it. But rest assured, if you were to do that, you hop on to this bike, bring it up, you can feel that this is something different. You can feel that the bike is like, wow, this is so light, so manageable. And then when you have 160 horsepower, V-twin engine, 75 degrees, you know, with all that KTM technology, I tell you, your smile. This one, you want to go to mana, Pakistan?
Pakistan, can.
You can. I mean, but you will enjoy this more on the highways. Plus, in the hands of a very capable off-road rider, this is also very good as well. So the R variant, again, orange frame, and it has longer suspension travel compared to the S variant. Later we take a look at the S lah. So the R has 21 inch front, 18 inch rear wheels. So it has that off-road punya punya wheel setting, easier for you to go over obstacle, jump, so on and so forth. But if you're looking at, yeah, Syarul, but I don't do heavy off-road. I like to do like very light off-road, kampung-kampung, kelapa sawit.
Mostly tarmac lah.
Tarmac, I enjoy. I like to betul corner, siku, elbow all down. Then, S would be the one.
Okay.
19-inch front wheel, 17-inch
rear wheel. And I noticed that this has a very prominent blue color, which is very similar to the KTM Tech 3.
Yes.
Oh my god, macam you put Red Bull, I think nice.
Yes, if you if you take the KTM Tech 3 fairing, right, you bring to Singapore, then you put side by side, the color tone is the same. Yeah.
You know one thing I like, the this bike, the head reminds me of Mas Rider Black. Mas Rider Black motorbike, you know.
The Kamen Riders.
Kamen Riders.
Alright. So this one also, again, ride by wire. Okay, keyless. Right, keyless. There's no physical ignition. Even the tank to open also keyless. Plus there's this compartment in front here, which is the handphone compartment. There's a USB port there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And it's very nice ah. It's like macam ada
sweet. So this has adjustable suspension, both front and rear, compression rebound, preload adjustable. And then if you see the controls ah, it is different from
macam floating ah.
Yeah, floating plus.
Oh my gosh.
If you rasa, you just have a feel lah. It's like a mouse click kind of
touch. Oh my god.
Yeah,
oh,
yes.
Like you clicking a mouse.
Clicking a mouse.
Sedap sah. Ah, yeah. Macam gamer lah.
So we have customers asking, hey, your 7-inch TFT, is it touchscreen?
No, is it? It's not. Oh, yeah, unfortunately. Because I think while you're riding, they don't want you to get distracted by your screen.
Yeah, and you, they don't want you to remove your left hand or either hands to go and touch that screen.
Which is why they provide the buttons for you.
And another thing, if it's raining, how you want to? The happy
And then if you, you are using gloves,
macam mana? So it becomes another issue for you to be concerned about. So might as well we just have a nice cluster of buttons that sedap will be gone. Okay. Because it feels like mouse click. And then we also have the collective setting C1 and C2. So this one is a collective setting. So you, if you have your group of settings that you put in into one cluster, and then you want that setting to be activated. So instead of going to the main page and blah blah blah, pichet. So you just go to the C1 or C2 lah.
Basically, it's like the home button.
Is it custom button?
Custom button. Yes. Now, before we finish off with this bike, okay, and this is the only piece that we have right now. In fact, this bike is about 1.5 weeks old here in the showroom.
So anybody booking already?
So far, belum ada lah. We have a lot of interested parties lah, of course.
I see. Wow.
Belum ada. So this is the only piece. So you are touching the only piece in Singapore, also. Yeah.
Okay. Reserved.
So I would like to share with you how the UI, the user interface, looks like on the 7-inch full color TFT. So it's keyless. All we need to do is just switch it on. And then it's
oh my god,
welcome note, ready to race.
So nice, yeah. Okay.
So it's full color, full display, very informative. So it's easy for you to read while you're on the road, so solar. And now you have the black backlight, which indicates you are riding in the dark or at night. So during the day, the backlight will turn to white color based on the sensor that's available.
Okay.
So let's go to see the setting. Let me see. All right. Bike information. So they have color-coded parts of the bike. So all you need to just focus to or just select where you want to go. So let's say you want to see tire pressure monitoring system, the front tire pressure. So in the event of you have low tire pressure due to leaking tire or so and so forth, so it will come out like that, and then we just indicate that your tire angin kurang. So as we go on, rear tire, coolant temperature, fuel, battery, so it highlights parts of the bike.
Okay. So, cool,
so if we go to the ride mode, they also have that display that you are riding in the rain. Okay. And then off road, you can see the graphic changes to off road and then street. And additional feature with the only available at Super Adventure S, not this one, will be the ACC. I'm not sure whether you're familiar with the adaptive cruise control. Yes. So I know there's only three in the market that's available. One BMW on the RT, with Ducati, the Matristrada, and us lah. But on the R, we don't have the ACC on. But I can show you where the ACC unit is supposed to be lah. I switch off first. So the ACC unit supposed to be here.
Oh, okay.
Kat sini. So later when we go to the S outside, I can show you the ACC is there. Right. So what ACC does, or adaptive cruise control, and it says, when you put on cruise control, the speed, the bike will adapt to whatever that's in front lah.
I see.
Radar detection, yeah.
So, I can't help to notice, but this one has a shorter windshield. Why is that so?
Why? Good question. Shall I give a demonstration or just explain to you?
Demo.
Alright. One of the reasons why we have a shorter screen in front is because you're gonna be like half squat. Okay, you're riding off-road, and then if let's say you take a jump when you land, you wouldn't want a tall screen to be here.
Okay.
So it can hentam you in the face.
I see.
Plus, you know, when I sit down, yes, there's decent amount of wind deflection protection from here, and I can bring this up just a bit lah. So the nature of our R variants, we don't want to have a tall full-size screen because of that impact lah.
I think I understand.
For safety reasons, yeah. Yes.
And I think plus, because of the windshield's degree, I think it should deflect the wind pretty well lah.
Okay, yeah, decent lah, decent. And plus, the adventure bikes are designed also in a way that when you're riding through light rain, your body, your low body is actually protected also. So you don't feel, I mean, you don't get that wet lah compared to any other bikes because it's protected as well. Alright, so as you can see, this is quite a big bike. All bike, but again, it's lower than our previous Super Adventure models lah. The seat height itself, and seat height is two position adjustable. You can set it at the lower or the higher position.
So short people wouldn't have an issue lah.
You have to adapt to it lah.
Eventually lah.
Of course, the seat height is about 80 close to 90 cm. Quite tall also. But as you ride the bike more, you get used to it. Shouldn't be a problem.
So what about the bikes outside?
Okay, yes. Shall we go?
Okay.
Right, so this is the ACC unit that I'm talking about. A lot of big bikes, big brands, they are now adapting to this technology lah. This technology has been in the trials for many years lah, couple of years. Because it has always been available with higher end cars, where the cruise control is adaptive. So this is the unit, so what it does is that it gives the bike information on what's in front of you lah. So you can just put the cruise control, not say let go of your hands or what lah, right? But you just, at least now the bike is assisting you to to the traffic in front.
But it's like similar technology you have in the Tesla, you know? Kind of interesting lah. It's not exactly self-driving, but at least it shows what's
not full autonomous lah, but at least it has, you have a function that's able to detect what's going on in front. Yeah. So that's the additional one. And the other cool features, the full color TFT is similar. The interface is similar to the Adventure. It's just that this one have another display for the suspension because this is semi-active electronic suspension. That one is manual adjustment. So you can set the suspension, the damping, the preload. And if you were to get the tech pack, right, the optional tech pack, you will have the pro suspension setting, which is another level of suspension adjustments that's available on this bike.
Yeah. So comment about the seat.
Seat sedap.
It's very nice.
Seat sedap.
It's very nice to the touch.
No, this is the kind of seat yang it doesn't bob water, you know.
Yeah.
Dia tak absorb water.
Yeah.
Tak absorb air.
Tak absorb water. From this camera angle, right, you can see the latest generation of Super Adventure and the previous one.
Oh, this is the previous generation?
The previous generation, yes. This is a Super Adventure S. So consider they are of the same model, different year only. Based on the same engine.
So but this one, the fuel tank is not like this.
Yeah, fuel tank sampai sini aja. Yeah. Whereby that one, they go all the way down. Fuel capacity is the same, 23 liters.
Okay.
So same electronic suspension, full color TFT. It's just that it doesn't have the additional bells and whistles that this fella have.
And interesting, there's no orange on it.
Oh yeah, we have two color variants on the Super Adventure S. One is the black grey, the other one is the orange one.
Oh, okay.
So orange will be like a dark grey with the orange strip, something like this color scheme.
Alright.
And plus, as you can see, this one the frame is black in color. So, and then this bike here also frame black in color. So meaning it's not the R variant. It's not the R. Behind.
Oh.
Yeah, so that one is the 2021 Super Adventure R. This is the 2019 Super Adventure R. R again, you see the orange color frame. So here you can see clearly, okay, this is much more taller compared to that Adventure. So from here, from where the camera is, you can see between these two bikes, which one is more for the streets, which one is more off-road. So what KTM did with their Super Adventure main line, what we did, it started off with one Super Adventure, and then after that, from that one, it breaks into two. We have the S and we have the R. Like BMW, BMW have the GS and the GS Adventure. So KTM started with Super Adventure, and then they have the Super Adventure T, S and R. So instead of giving you that one bike, you can do all, now you can do a bit more on certain riding perspective. So this one more off-road, that one more for the streets, that one can place track one. Sepang also kan.
So Syarul, can you share to us about the RC8 though?
Alright, the RC.
Oh, this is like a legendary bike, you know?
Legend, yes. Me personally, I call it the king. If we have the beast, we have the king also. So the RC8R stopped production in 2016. Reason being, KTM doesn't want to produce a high 200 horsepower, street legal sports bike. So okay, that's why they stopped production on the RC8. And they focus on producing a 178 horsepower naked bike. So it's like, I don't want to give you this, but then I give you something else.
Okay. Right?
So of course, and then plus, if you compare to technology wise, this bike at that time, compared to the big four brands, Yamaha, Suzuki, Kawasaki and also Honda, this one a bit lagging in terms of technology. Yeah. It doesn't have ABS. The only electronic that's available on this bike is just fuel injection. They tak ada traction control. So it's pure
mechanical.
Pure rider, raw power. But why it still catches the eye of a lot of people, because this bike was designed somewhere in the mid 2000s. It have the same design over the generations and last produced in 2016. And today 2021, we take a look at the bike, it still looks very futuristic.
Yes.
So meaning 10 years later when we see this bike, this bike not outdated. It's a nice bike, it's something that is nice to look at. Compared to other super bikes, this one also the riding posture a bit forgiving lah. It's not really forgiving lah.
It's not really forward lah.
Not much. It doesn't really demand.
So how many are there on of this model on the road Singapore
right now? I would say I don't have the exact number, but I would say about 20-ish lah.
Oh my god.
RC8 and the RC8R. Yeah, so this is the RC8R. Here is the 200cc.
The 200 joke. This one everywhere.
This one everywhere. This is the 391. So just now, I kena snook pasal double locking, right? Yeah. Yes, this one boleh lock dua-dua side. Because of the lever sensitive part.
So, you care to an introduction about the bike.
Okay, in terms of brand, yes, it has a different brand. This is the Husqvarna, where the other one is a KTM. But they have the same engine. They have a lot of similarities in terms of the suspension that it has, in terms of the brake that it have, the brake calipers, everything is similar. Difference is the brand and the styling, of course. So this one looks more like a cafe racer, old school scrambler kind of look.
Naked, more naked.
Yeah, more naked. But the seat height is a bit taller compared to the Dukes. Slightly taller. So slightly taller, and then when you sit on the bike, you take a look at the cute meter. Meter dia cute. Right. It's very cute. It's LCD with blue background. So reason why Husqvarna created such a very simplistic kind of meter, so that you only use this meter just to glance whatever going on, what's the speed, and then you just
focus more on the road.
On the road.
Yeah.
So when you sit on the bike, you feel that it's very free, you know, like there's nothing in front of you, because of that simplicity in the front design. The engine is based on the Duke. They're actually about the same.
For those who need any advice about this particular model, can just refer to the
Duke rider. Yes. But but the thing about there are some parts or components that's not one to one exchangeable, but the engines are the same in general.
So production in?
This one produced in India.
Same with the Dukes lah.
Yes. All our Class 2B and Class 2A bikes are produced in India. Yeah. Except the first generation of the Svartpilen and Vipilen, which are the 401s. That one is from Mati Open. So, and the first generation Duke 125 many years ago, that one's from Mati Open as well.
Okay. You know, I like one thing I like about the design of this model is the boxy fuel tank, you know, and then with this
rack.
This rack.
Right. Okay.
It's a rack.
Okay. So as you can see, this is actually the tank cover. So it complement the whole design of the bike lah. Plus, this can also act as a slider or tank protector.
Oh, okay.
So, in the event of, you know, the bike falling down, so this protects this area. The physical tank is actually under the covers lah. Right? Okay. Another unique feature is, of course, this nice bronze looking tank.
Oh, it's really nice. Huh? Yeah, it's very nice.
So even tell you to lift, angkat, lift. Okay. Another thing, as you can see this rack here, people are wondering, what's this rack for?
That's right.
Okay, we have the magnetic tank bag.
Oh, okay.
Alright, so this tank bag, there's no physical straps or bungee cords required.
Yeah.
Because the bag has three magnet points that's connected directly to the three magnet points of the rack itself. So this here are magnets.
So this is a universal design, is it?
Only available on the Svartpilen 200. The Svartpilen 400 has a rack, but they don't have magnets on it. The Vitpilen 401 doesn't have the rack at all. So because we like the design of the bike lah, and you can see it won't really complement to have a top box.
Yeah.
So
it's
if
not
you
really
have something
nice
that you need to carry, like your wallet, passport, handphone. And then you need like a nice place to put it. Just put there the tank bag, rectangular tank bag. You arrive your destination, you just pull and tarik.
So this bike was not designed to have
box. Yes.
In place lah.
Yeah. We have options of saddle bags lah, left and right. But we don't have the option of a rack and a top box for this model because it's meant to be just like that. Very nice.
What's the story about this RC?
Well, this RC, as you can see, background picture, nampak? Okay, it has the similar DNA. So what we see here is the RC Cup bikes that was actively racing about 5 years ago. Unfortunately, the RC Cup has stopped due to obvious reasons, COVID and so on. So, what we have here is the RC390 with some additional or modifications to it lah. Engine is still stock RC390 engine, but we have the engine casing, the full system, exhaust, and also the power parts this year lah. So this bike is actively taking part in the local track days organized by Singamoto at KF1. I use this bike just to practice lah, for practice. As you can see, the tire also is a street legal SC2 tire. But this bike is not street legal at all lah.
Yeah, I can see already.
Yeah, you're not riding on the streets.
From the way it is.
So it has the WP suspension, fully adjustable. Then this one is for practice, and I have that one for racing.
Oh, that one's for racing.
Yes.
Oh my God, the Duke 390, right?
Duke 390, yes. So this is Duke 390 that I'm racing for this year. So this bike has helped me to be where I am today in the racing scene. So what we have here is a 2015 390 Duke. The engine is original, but of course we have some modifications and changes to it lah. First, we need to change is the controls of the bike, the suspension. I have changed the brakes also. But
okay.
I'm still using the stock calipers and bigger rotos, full system exhaust, and quick shifter system.
Transmission is different.
Yeah, so quick shifter.
GP shift.
I'm still using standard shift.
I see.
Standard
shift. Gosh. Quick shifter. Quick shifter.
Quick shifter, if for those who are not familiar, what is quick shifter? Is the ability to change your gears without closing your throttle and pulling the clutch. So only to just open your throttle.
I know what Zai is thinking already. I know what Zai is thinking already. Macam kapcai.
No.
Oh, kapcai using centrifugal clutch, so it's different. So quick shifter, you are on the gas. So kapcai, you wouldn't want to do that. If you are on the gas, you kapcai and then you change. It's like so quick shifter. It allows you to stay with throttle open and change your gears without closing your throttle and pulling the clutch. So shifting of gears will be very very fast, quicker lah, much quicker. And there's other if you have another higher spec of quick shifter, will be the quick shifter plus or the auto blipper lah, where you can do downshifting without clutching in. Yeah.
I see.
So I'm using quick shifter. So these are the things that I have on the bike. that's racing right now lah in the Singamoto National Championship. So I'm representing the wheel for the race, and then currently I'm fourth position in the overall championship.
Yeah, not bad, not bad.
Fourth position, top five. Guess how many KTMs in the top five?
Well, I think three.
Three. Three KTMs in the top five, all three 90s, two RC and one Duke lah. Mm. And plus, like I mentioned just now, I'm very happy to see that we have a majority of the participants in the assorted category that I'm racing in. Mm-hmm. They are using KTM 390s, either the Dukes or the RC. So easily, if we have 15 racers, right? 15 riders, 9, 10 of them will be on a KTM 390.
Ready to race.
Ready to race.
Oh my god, I might just switch to a KTM after this.
okay, alright. So, thank you for coming, and then I believe I've already explained a lot of our bikes over here lah. So now it's time for me to ask you all a question. What do you know about KTM, or what have you heard about KTM as the brand and as a bike? Can you just share with us for the viewers out there?
For me, I heard KTM, the acronym kuat telah minyak.
And then for me, the stereotypical perception is KTM motor sakit.
Okay. So we've heard this many times, many years. So just to share with you, the acronym of KTM stands for Krung Reef and Truck and Pulse Marty Hoffman. The founder, the shareholder, or the benefactor, and the place where it started from, like in Austria. When you say that, motor kuat telan minyak, maybe that stigma or the perception started when KTM comes in as a scrambler bikes, two stroke, suck a lot of petrol. I don't know whether it's still available, applicable right now lah, kuat telan minyak. But of course, when you have bikes that produce so much power, you definitely need more fuel. Our most powerful bike, which is a Super Duke R, average fuel consumption is about, I would say, 16 kilometers per liter. If you ride sensibly lah, if you were to push it, you get about 13 plus kilometers per liter. Still pretty decent for such a powerful bike, 180 horse, 146 newton meters of torque, so quite decent lah. The Super Adventures, they can produce about 18 kilometers per liter, Singapore riding. The Dukes, about 20 plus, higher 20s lah. Even the 790 Adventure can produce about 28 to 30 kilometers per liter on average. Okay, so and then yours will be the Motosaki.
Sick bike lah.
So about Motosaki this, or the bike that gets
problematic
easily. Wow, there's a lot of dynamics to it. One would be when someone were to shy away from necessary servicing or repair stuff due to cost. Okay, we cannot judge someone, or we cannot judge someone because you cannot afford like this, based on the rider themselves. So we cannot mock someone because they can't afford to do it. But just because of that part, when you're supposed to do the necessary repairs and changes, it doesn't happen. And it just snowball. And it becomes talk of the town, and it becomes a stigma. And then people say, KTM motor problematic. So if it is so true, and you see a lot of KTMs on the roadside, the expressways.
probably nobody buying KTMs.
Basically, KTM is a motor manja lah. You need to pamper the bike lah.
Yes. I believe everything also need to be pampered. Everything, every bike also you need a level of maintenance care, tender love, you want to put it lah. It's whether how much or how little. So KTM, yes, because the bike is, to me personally, is special. It has such a character. It have its good days, got the bad days. So when it have bad days, and then the motor starts to feel like, hey, something is not right. And then if I were to just continue not doing anything about it, then too bad lah. It will just escalate, so and so forth lah. The thing about KTM, we service the bike by mileage. So that is something which strictly need to follow. If the rider just follow the servicing interval, if you're supposed to do this, you do this. You're supposed to do that, you do that. You're gonna supposed to spend this amount to do this repair. Because when you send it for servicing, technician will take a look at the mileage, see what's that's necessary needs to be done. If there are 10 things that you're supposed to do, but you just say, I just want to do 5, then you just have another 5 of problems that are going to snowball. And that's where the motorcycle comes.
I see.
Yeah, but generally, it's like you don't buy a Ferrari and send to a normal workshop. That kind of thing, you know. You buy that for that brand, for the purpose, it's supposed to be spent like that. So that's how I look at it. It's a nice bike to ride.
So Abang Syarul, thank you so much. I think you covered almost everything. Almost everything.
One last.
It's okay. We provide you a platform to talk.
Okay, these two gentlemen here, I would like to ask.
Yeah.
If you are given a chance to get your own KTM, Mr. Fahan, which one would you
Oh my god. Actually, I like the RC390.
Okay.
You know, for a long time, I like the is the sports bike design is very nice. It's very unique, very different from most of the sports bikes out there in the market lah.
So you want RC390 for the road or for the track? Because for the track, you can take my one.
But looking at the practical kind of perspective, for me, I'm an adventure rider lah. Not so much of a racer. I would definitely get maybe an adventure bike.
Okay, which one?
I don't know, man.
I think I like the Adventure R.
I also like the Adventure R.
Not too much, not too little, just nice. Yes.
Good luck. Maybe the Duke 1290. Yeah. Actually, orange is my favorite color lah. That's why I like KTM actually.
So I mean, it's nice lah to know that you guys also appreciate our brand and you also know which brand or which bike model that you want to get for yourself lah.
Yep.
Most maybe one day you can get one.
Yep.
You'll be
hinting.
You'll be an experienced one. If you want, later you come and see me.
Okay. But if I have the capability, right, money, I would love to get this bike. The two strokes.
Yeah, 150.
I mean, I'm a fan of two stroke bikes, That's why.
This one, if you're gonna ride off road, you will enjoy because it's so light. There's power to it. Plus, this is the type of bike you don't mind falling and getting up for 10 or more times. Doesn't really wear you out. The bigger CC is like the 4 strokes, 250 or the 350s. You know, you waste a lot of energy falling down, getting up, falling down. That's enduro riding.
Yeah.
So when you have such a small CC and light, you save a lot of energy, and then when you save a lot of energy, you ride better, you focus better, you enjoy the ride. So.
I mean, this is KTM specialty lah. They are more specialized on dirt bikes lah. Abang Syarul, just one question. Maybe you can help for out there, people right taking class 2B. Maybe they are looking at KTM or what? What would you say to these riders?
Buy. Come and buy. To start off. Our class 2B bikes, the Spark Pillion 200, which is from Husqvarna, and the 200 Duke from KTM. If I'm not mistaken, these are the only two models that have a full 200cc in a class 2B.
Yeah, people usually want to maximize the 200cc. Oh,
budget.
Yeah.
But other than that, the Honda 190, Yamaha 155.
So, I've heard class 2B riders wanting getting the KTM Duke 200 because they want to maximize the CC.
Plus with that, you have the WP Apex suspension, the brakes. From KTM. Quality is there, performance is there.
And there's this reputation about the Duke 200, whereby I've yet to test out. I cannot save myself. But the Duke 200 is very talky. That's the reputation lah among the class 2B bikes.
Do you want a
test bike?
Actually I plan.
Orang yang pernah buat.
Maybe lah.
Duke. my recommendation would be just buy. I mean, if you have questions or doubts, please.
Yeah, to be right, new guys, you to be riders or just about to pass just or still pass. Taking and thinking of KTM, Brother Syarul here can actually poison
there's
you.
Me and my colleagues in the showroom here or Templates, we are very gladly to assist you lah. We can share with you what the good points, what can be the not say bad points lah, what you need to look out for, plus minus. So please just come down to Bukit Merah here, 1008 Bukit Merah Lane, and try to look for me. I'll be here. You can look for my clicks. So rest assured, come here, no obligation. You can just chit chat, talk about. As you can see, today we just chit chat about the bikes.
We never talk about the price. Touch one later. Talk about the bike first. So yeah, just okay. Calm down. Yeah, regardless whether 2B, 2A or class 2 also lah.
So Sharul, thank you so much. We are very heartened and honored to have you here on the show. I mean, thank you to Kai and Harif.
Yeah.
Also, especially Kai, who's over there. Come here lah. Come here lah. So Kai, remember we reviewed his RC 390. Yeah, he sold away the bike. Now he's riding a Super Duke R.
Welcome to the club, actually.
I haven't yet buy, bro. and Harif also we reviewed his 390 lah. So thank you guys for arranging this
showroom tour
with Abang Sharul over here and the guys at the wheel. Been awesome.
So feel free to come. We are open from Monday to Saturday, from morning till evening lah, from 9:30 to 6. You just come down and I can chit-chat with us. We'll take a look at the bikes. So thank you very much for your time today.
Thank you, Abang Sharul, and we'll see you in the next one.